favourite song is Better Days. I've been listening to that loads recently. And I think it's real. It's got that kind of almost sad emotion, but positive overall. I'd love to know where you were when you wrote it and how that idea came about for it.
Well, funnily enough, that was, it's really strange. Some songs can take months. Some songs you can be scratching your head over for a while. And other songs, it's almost like you're grabbing it from the air. It just seems to be there. And that Better Days was kind of one of those. I remember going to Paul's house. And usually when me and Paul get together to write, it's with him on the guitar and me humming melodies. And then I'll take the idea away and fit words around the melody.
Okay.
But he'd kind of written this on the piano. So I went to his house and he showed me the piano riff, really. And I kind of immediately came up with that melody sat in his music room. And it just seemed so simple, but quite effective and quite kind of catchy. Because sometimes if I do a melody, I have to record it straight away so I don't forget it.
Right.
But I kind of came home when we'd kind of agreed that the melody suited the piano. I came straight home, and I do remember sitting on my settee at home, and it took me about 20 minutes to write all of those words out. Which is very unusual, really. There's usually a lot more involved than that, but it just seemed to just fall out. It's weird. When you can sense something like that happening, you have to really finish it, because you know if you leave it for a month and go back to it, you know it's never going to be the same. So, and that, I'm quite proud of that song. That's probably one of my favorites off the album, just again simply because of the sentiment. And as you've rightly said, it's quite dark, but then there is hope. There's always got to be hope, and especially the world we've been living in for the last year.
Yeah. If you remember where you were with Chasing Rainbows, you're maybe arguably standout hit, if you remember where you were when you wrote it.
Yeah, well, that's another one, very, very weirdly, very similar to Better Days, in the sense that it was almost grasped from the sky. And it's weird that after I've said that about the Better Days scenario, but my memories of that are we'd gone on a really big European tour. And that was happening for a good 2 or 3 months all over Europe, living out of bags and stuff. And that's what you have to do. I'm not moaning about that. But then it does get to the point where you just do need to have a bit of a break. Me and Paul were sat on the top of the bus. We were homesick, thinking, right, let's just get through this last gig and then we can get home. And then Paul picked up his guitar and started doing that opening riff to Chasing Rainbows. So I'm looking at him again, saying, what's that? I don't know, it's just what I'm doing. And I immediately started going, and I'm started scribbling a few lyrics down, and pretty quickly came up with the I've been chasing rainbows all my life bit, because it's all about the just being wanting to go home, really.
Sure.
So we then took that into the sound check, quickly showed it to the rest of the band. They kind of got a rudimentary idea of the chords, and we just played around it in the sound check, and even our crew were looking at it going, what's that? And we said, well, we've just written it. So we knew we were onto quite a winner with that, if we got our crew's attention straight away with it. So that was one of those happy accidents as well, I guess, where we took that home, bashed it into the proper shape and recorded it quickly so that we could release it. Because it wasn't actually, that was released on Let It Ride, which didn't come out till 1998. But because we wrote it so quick in 96, we wanted to kind of keep the maximum high momentum. Yeah. That meant, apparently, in 1996, we were the only act to have 5 top 40 hits that year. I could We're very lucky in the sense that we did manage to write a body of work that has stood the test of time with people. I think that's what it is, really, at the end of the day.
I think there's almost like an unmeasurable of, although people buy songs, it's how much people like songs. You know what I mean? So you can't like press play harder on your CD player, but somehow that comes across them when people are singing the songs and liking them. You mentioned Standby. Would you be able to tell us, or can you recall how that was formed? Would you stay on standby? Because I need another alibi in the wrong place. Well, giving birth, maybe.
Well, I do. The only memory of that I have is me and Paul wrote that around my kitchen table. That's the only memory. I can't quite remember how much of it we managed to write around the kitchen table, but probably the main bones of it. But more interestingly, that was off our 1996 album, A Maximum High. So we'd had our debut album out, and then we spent a year off writing A Maximum High. And we live in York, and we were struggling to find somewhere to be able to practice and play loud in a rehearsal capacity and write songs.
Okay.
And I think Tom, our bass player, got talking to a lad whose dad owned a potato plant just outside of York. The son of Mr. Cockerill was a bit of a fan of us and said, there's a disused office area within the plant. If you want to go and set up in there, you've got the freedom, you can play as loud as you want, you can come and go as you want. So we found ourselves writing most of Maximum High in a potato plant, which was quite funny at the time, because there'd be a window there and you just see all of these tractors pulling loads of potatoes in and out. But so that's the romance of rock and roll right there, isn't it?